Hello and welcome to Wrecked with Rechtenwald. I'm your host, Michael Rechtenwald. I'm here today with NYU Media Studies professor Mark Crispin Miller. He's written numerous books, including Boxed In, The Culture of TV, Seeing Through Movies, Cruel and Unusual, and Fooled Again. Mark is a firebrand. He's catching all kinds of flack these days at NYU for his course on propaganda. We talk about COVID propaganda, the contemporary left, and much more. How are you today, Mark?
Hi, Mike. How's it going?
Pretty well, despite the onslaught of total bullshit.
Yeah, I guess I could say the same. It's an achievement, you know.
Yeah, and the current climate, that's for sure. So many will know your story by now. You've been on Heavyweight Podcast, but I wanted to give you a chance to elaborate before you end up on Joe Rogan.
You know, there's a backstory to it that I've never discussed that, you know, you might appreciate.
Yeah, I mean, absolutely. It started before this episode, right?
Yeah, well, I mean, I think probably most of the people watching know the story of what happened to me in the fall. And in case there are some who don't, I'll tell it very, very succinctly. But what most people don't know is that this was actually the third attempt to take me down at NYU last year, the year of COVID, coincidentally. The first thing that happened was, I think in February, I got an email from the Office of Equal Opportunity telling me that my conduct had come under scrutiny, and I was completely gobsmacked by this. I couldn't imagine what that meant. And when I emailed back asking what it was about, they said it was about some of my comments, I think, on gender identity or gender relations, one or the other. And they wouldn't tell me anymore. So I, you know, retained a law firm. It cost me $6,000. And they basically told me to say as little as possible. And I don't think that was worth $6,000. But anyway, I went in very curious to know what this was about. And these two lawyers told me that a colleague whom they named had reported me submitting four of my online writings to the office and claiming that they showed I was guilty of transphobia. Now, the four online writings were one short piece I'd written for my listserv, News from Underground, and three facetious Facebook comments, okay? The short piece, which I stand behind, and which was online, I mean, it really had nothing to do with my, you know, teaching or anything. It was a meditation on why there would be a Sprite commercial featuring a mother breastfeeding her daughter. I thought this was bizarre. Why would the Coca-Cola company, you know, which owns Sprite, be making a commercial like that? I mean, do they actually think there's a huge untapped soft drink market for, you know, trans teenagers? And I speculated that the reason why these transnational corporations, you know, not only Coca-Cola, but Starbucks too, would be making commercials that spotlight trans, I would say trans ideology, could conceivably have something to do with a eugenics agenda. There's a lot of elite funding for the trans movement. And I think that has to do not only with, you know, this is people like Warren Buffett and George Soros. They actually fund the trans movement. This could be due in part to their interests in big pharma and the medical industrial complex, because transitioning is very, very profitable. But I also speculated that it could have something to do with the eugenics agenda, because trans ideology, pushed to its extreme realization, of course, entails the sterilization and or mutilation of children, you know, who will then grow up not to procreate. And I've been studying the history of eugenics and Bill Gates's involvement with it and all that. So I wrote this. And the three facetious Facebook comments were written in protest of the policy of allowing biological males to compete in girls and women's athletics. Okay. All right. So those were my sins. And I have to say the two lawyers are very rational. You know, they asked me all these questions about my website. Do I make my students read anything there, which I don't? I don't require that they join my listserv. It's just something I do on the side. And I don't teach the subject of transgenderism, although it does come up sometimes. I said all this to them, and I didn't say as little as possible. I was, you know, quite voluble on the subject because I feel strongly about it. I wondered aloud why this, how this colleague got those writings, because she's neither a member of my list, nor is she a Facebook friend. And they told me that somebody else in the department had gotten hold of them and given them to her. Okay. And I actually think I know who that is. So they said to me at the end, this was like for an hour I talked to them. And they said, well, we'll let you know next week if we're going to proceed, right? It's kind of a Kafka-esque experience. But as it happens, the next day they emailed me early in the day and said, we're dropping this. Okay. So I beat that rap. All right.
Yeah.
I didn't know that there was more to come. All right, the second thing that happened, and this is even more astonishing, is that in June of 2020, I got this email from my department chair saying, I hate to be the bearer of bad news, but we got these four comments from students in your master's course on propaganda. This course was the previous fall. Okay, this was in June. And as you can see, you know, they're very upset with the way you taught the course. And so I would like you to consider revising your course description, presumably to say, you know, I want you to be warned that I'm going to be pounding you over the head with lunatic conspiracy theories. I mean, that was the implication. He thought that I had offered the course on propaganda under false pretenses, and that I was actually going to be riding my hobby horses in class. You know, the moon landing was a hoax. 9/11 was an inch. You know, that was his notion of how I teach. So my first response, I'm sure you'll relate to this, was to you know, fire off. I mean, I was tempted to fire off this defensive description of my course, which I started writing, and I realized, you know, fuck this. I went back and I gathered together all these glowing emails of thanks from students, including four students in that course, and then a whole bunch of others. So I sent them like 36, you know, really effusive expressions of gratitude for opening their eyes. I mean, you get these kinds of emails, you know what I'm talking about. And these were just from the last 18 months. And I said, look, those students who sent those four comments are clearly outliers. I'm not going to change my course description. So, you know, that's that. And he backed off. All right, you know what? All right. Now, I found subsequently, because of my lawsuit, which, and I'll tell the story of that in like a minute and a half, an exhibit that one of my colleagues actually submitted in their motion to dismiss my suit. I don't think they're getting very good legal advice, because what this exhibit contained was the one email that some of them had gotten complaining about my course, and they plucked four sentences out of it and represented it to me as the complaints of four students. Your viewers know this, the prequel to what happened to me in the fall, okay? I'll make this very quick. I teach a course on propaganda. I make it very clear that I don't teach it as a remote academic subject, but as something in real time, and I warn the students that they will often be reading evidence of counter narratives that may freak them out. And once they start digging into these things, they'll find that they are learning things that may put them at odds with roommates, friends, family, and so on, which often happens. Anyway, the example I used of something we could discuss is the mask mandates. And I urged them to read all the scientific literature on masking. You know, both the considerable body of randomized controlled trials finding that masks don't work at blocking respiratory viruses, and then the more recent studies, you know, looser studies finding otherwise. And I urged them to read all of them. And a student who joined the class late and wasn't present for that introductory discussion took violent exception to the subject we were discussing. It came up again for 20 minutes when she was in the class, and she flipped out on Twitter. She didn't say anything in the class, but on Twitter, she demanded that NYU fire me. And that was, you know, unpleasant, but not like a major tragedy. But then NYU immediately took her side. My department chair tweeted his thanks to her and said, we as a department have made this a priority and are discussing next steps. This was a formal public expression of departmental support for the student demanding I be fired for mask heresy, putting the students at risk and so on. The next day, the dean and the doctor who determines NYU's COVID policy emailed my other students without putting me on copy, hinting that I'd given them dangerous information and giving them links to the recent studies, telling them to believe those, which I never do that. I never tell them what to think. And then I was pressured into dropping the course for the spring semester, which just ended. All right, so I put up a petition at change.org that your viewers can find if they haven't heard of it or signed it. Just a request that NYU respect my academic freedom, but I did it in the name of all those who've been silenced or punished for their views, not just professors, journalists, doctors, scientists, everybody. This petition incensed my department colleagues, I'd say most of them, who then a month later, and this is the crux, sent a letter to the dean demanding that he order a review of my conduct and accusing me not only of discouraging my students from wearing masks, which is fantasy, but and this you will find all too familiar, explicit hate speech, attacks on students and others in our community, advocating for an unsafe learning environment, assailing my students with non-evidence-based arguments and microaggressions and aggressions, okay? None of which I've ever done. And the dean went right ahead and ordered the review without even talking to me. And when we finally did speak, he said it was because NYU's lawyers had told him he must, okay? Which is false, legally speaking, completely false. So I went through the letter. I wrote a very detailed rebuttal. I requested a retraction and an apology. They ignored it, the request. I sent it again a week later. They ignored it again. So I'm suing them for libel. 25 signed the letter. 6 of them are junior faculty. I'm not suing the junior faculty. So I am suing 19 colleagues for libel. And there is a GoFundMe page up. I expect this to be a costly endeavor. They filed a motion to dismiss. We responded and they replied. And this is like 3 months ago by now. So at any moment the judge could rule. And if he grants the motion to dismiss, we will appeal. And if he denies it, we'll proceed. I think I've probably made clear that I suspect NYU is guiding this, and this is something we can discuss, I think, very fruitfully, because on the one hand, you have all these woke faculty who are, always more progressive than thou, and whose idea of, progressive politics is the sort of tribal identity politics. They really hammered on the transphobia accusation in their letter, even though I was cleared of this early in the year by the appropriate authorities, I guess you could say, you got all these woke faculty encouraging woke students. But I think they function as an instrument in the hands of a corporate university. Board of Trustees is really kind of stunning in its plutocratic character. You know, these are people like Larry Fink, BlackRock. I mean, these are people on Wall Street and in corporate law and in the real estate world and in the Chinese government and in the government of Abu Dhabi who have their own agenda. And are perfectly happy to use woke persecution to shut down or get rid of faculty like me. I've been circulating a lot of heretical or dissident, I should say, COVID information, stuff about the so-called vaccines for well over a year, you know, since I got over my own initial panic over COVID, because, you know, I was 70 years old, Lyme disease. But once I began to, sort of find my feet again and look into the evidence and so on and talk to epidemiologists and others and read news from all over, I saw that this was an enormous propaganda drive and its purpose has nothing to do with public health. And I think that NYU is the kind of institution, correct me if I'm wrong, that doesn't want any audible contradiction of prevailing narratives. If you walk around the neighborhood down here, you'll see, you know, filling the windows of ground floor buildings on Broadway and other side streets, these huge sort of Soviet style propaganda photographs of these, you know, from a low angle, you know, these heroic faces of masked nurses and masked people of color.
So how do we know we're in the midst of propaganda? What are the telltale signs?
That's a very good question. I mean, one of the things I tell my students at the beginning of the year, in order to make clear to them that this kind of study really requires that you be willing to move out of your comfort zone, I make the point that we can always spot propaganda that we don't agree with, right? So you ask a liberal for an example and he'll say Fox News, and you do the same thing on the right and they'll say MSNBC, and they're both right, also half blind because they can't spot it when it pushes their buttons. So once you begin making the necessary effort to kind of pull back a little bit and be as impartial as you can, you will often find, as I continue to find, okay, and I'm much older than those students, that something you've believed, sometimes fervently, has turned out to be false. And I know you certainly had that experience. I have, repeatedly. And that can be, you know, that can be very unsettling. Now, to answer your question, with a media system like ours, in which like five transnational corporations own or control like 90% at least of what most people take in, and each of them owns pieces of the others, you know, so it's a real cartel, it's an octopus.
Right.
And to boot, it's extremely close to the government, right? They're pretty close relations with the state. And the same goes for the major so-called social media platforms. They're very close to the military and the CIA in many cases. So when you have a media system like that, I think it's safe to say that when you hear the same story everywhere you look, everywhere you listen, that's probably a propaganda narrative, especially if it entails a kind of strident vilification of anybody who dissents, mm-hmm. right? Either vilification or censorship. So the necessary obverse of propaganda is always censorship, because propaganda does not want any argument. In this way, it's different from, you know, classical oratory, like rhetoric. The tools of rhetoric are for people who are involved in speaking before an assembly and making an argument, and then somebody else will come up and make another argument. Like that's perfectly democratic and necessary for democracy and indeed for science, you know, knowledge generally.
Mm-hmm.
Propaganda doesn't do that. Propaganda wants to fill your mind to the exclusion of all else, and it wants to fill all the available space to the exclusion of all else. It is totalitarian in its inclination. See,
mm-hmm.
So you know, if you are seeing everywhere these, for example, these lurid, terrifying accounts of hospitals overrun, you know, and heroic medical personnel doing their best to take care of them. You know, and you go for a walk. You walk past a hospital in your neighborhood, and it's like crickets. There's nobody there. I mean, a lot of people had this experience last spring, right here in New York. I think this is like a disconnect going on here. That's all propaganda. And to the extent that you, I mean, let me be perfectly blunt. If you've escaped to your house upstate, some of my colleagues have done, and their whole sense of what's happening in the city comes from the New York Times and NPR and the rest of them, even Fox News. We'll have a few dissenters in primetime slots, which is fortunate. They're going to freak out, and they have. They freaked out. I can't think of a single New York Times-driven propaganda narrative that they don't believe totally. They haven't swallowed hook, line, and sinker, you know.
Yeah.
And that's not just my colleagues. That's the professional classes generally. You know, they bought Russiagate, although Russiagate was ludicrous, you know. And they think Biden won the election last year. And
right.
Anyone who questions that is like a Nazi. And it's just, it's weird for me to have this experience around that election, because I am well known for having doggedly tracked Republican election thefts, you know, for Bush Cheney and the Republicans generally.
As did I, Mark, as you know, and you followed the website, Citizens for Legitimate Government. I started that website, legitgov.org. I protested the Bush v. Gore election. I thought it was election theft, and I still do. I spoke on the Capitol steps in opposition to the election theft. And then I, you know, see now today, the left has become aligned with corporate America, the political establishment, the military-industrial complex, the intelligence agencies. I mean, what has happened here? How did this left, how did they get roped in to supporting all of these institutions and now stand for nothing but pro-establishment positions?
That's like a great question. You know, you and I could collaborate on a whole book about this. This is
right.
Really important, right? It's been a long time coming, all right? The proximate cause of this bizarre metamorphosis was Donald Trump, okay?
It's right.
Trump's election. And let me add, I think there's considerable evidence that he wasn't really elected the first time. You know, the swing state votes appear to me to have been rigged. And I think he was as surprised as everybody else when he was told he won. And not many people know that they didn't even have an acceptance speech written, because their own polling told them very clearly that Hillary Clinton was going to win, which I think she was going to do, you know, and that which would have been, you know, hideous. Donald Trump, you know, by unexpectedly making Trump president and having already begun the propaganda equating him with Hitler, right? Because before that election, the Times featured a book review by Michiko Kakutani. It's like their veteran book reviewer. I think it might even have been on the front page. I'm not sure about that. Maybe it was on the front page of the book section. But it was a new biography of Hitler. And the whole review, I think this was in October of 2016, its beginning, which sort of described Hitler without naming him. The rhetorical trick was then to say, you know, this is actually Hitler, but doesn't it sound like Trump, you see? So that was already in the works. So Trump became, you know, the obsessive focus of liberal / progressive opinion, you know, animus. it was really a kind of a masterstroke. I mean, I have a friend who calls it Operation Trump. He was so, you know, overwhelmingly dominant in the consciousness of really everyone, in a way, that he was controlling everybody's thinking so that, you know, his supporters would reflexively believe every single thing he said. And his detractors, the haters, you know, reflexively believe the opposite of everything he said, right? So the whole COVID thing ended up being utterly politicized. I mean, to a really insane and lethal degree, because, you know, when Trump, as the verb they always use is touted, when he touted hydroxychloroquine, he was right. Just so happens he was absolutely right. Many, many studies have confirmed this, clinical practice. There's no question about it. But, you know, Dr. Fauci's sitting in the back when he clutches his head, you know, and everybody thinks, oh, yeah, whoa, that Trump, he so irresponsibly lies, you know. That was a tragic, tragically successful stroke of propaganda, because countless people would be alive today if they'd taken it.
Or ivermectin, for that matter.
It's even more effective. And they never talk about it because it's all vaccines, vaccines, vaccines. So, you know, and then Trump was said to be the personification of everything that the social justice people detest. You know, it's a swaggering masculinist figure and so on. So it completely warped their view of what's actually going on. And it ended up perversely making the CIA and FBI look heroic, you know, because they all swallowed the Russiagate fable, right? And they ended up, you know, loving Hillary Clinton and Biden and all these people who are warmongers. And, you know, like all of them are, they are, you know, they whore for the banks, you know. There's nothing progressive about the Democratic Party, nothing, or the CIA, or the FBI, or anybody else who came out against Trump. Even George W. Bush was rehabilitated. And now I'm blanking on his name, you know, the guy who was a Navy veteran, he'd been a POW, and he had a big state funeral.
McCain,
yeah, John McCain, even John Bolton.
All the neocons.
It takes, you know, there are no words to describe how perverse and wrong this is. So that was a necessary move, you know, to put Trump in to draw that kind of fire. And let me add, too, that he proved to be especially useful because in his representation as Hitler reincarnated, he and the Proud Boys, like the SA, you know, like the stormtroopers and stuff, they succeeded in distracting the attention of the left from the actual totalitarianism lowering all around us, even as we speak. It's really advanced to a totally alarming degree with this mandatory vaccination program and, you know, draconian constraints on civil liberties and all the rest of it. They keep pointing at Trump. Even now, you know, they can't give it up. They loved hating him, right?
So they used the Trump derangement syndrome to get the otherwise oppositional forces on their side. Now, what about wokeness? How does that tie in?
Yeah, that's a really good question. I mean, it seems to me that it is primarily, though not only, useful as an instrument of permanent division. You know, it has fractured the left into different tribes and then created this enormous chasm between all of those tribes on the one hand and everybody else on the other. And there's a huge population of Americans who are not racists, who are actually quite diverse themselves, and who are, they have no interest in this, any of this agenda, you know. I mean, you just talk to working people of all colors, what they think of mask mandates and vaccines and so on, and they completely get it. It seems to me, you know,
yeah.
I mean, the ones I've talked to. I mean, in the city here, one of the few things you can still do is find people like that, right? And they, you know, their way they see the world is the opposite of the way, you know, my colleagues and other left activists see the world. So it has, I mean, this is maybe the oldest tactic in the imperial playbook to divide and conquer.
Absolutely. And I think another element in the playbook is the notion of white privilege. And what better way to set the stage for the Great Reset than by convincing enough people that they're undeserving of what they have and should relinquish it?
I was just going to say that. Yeah. The Great Reset entails the elimination of property and the elimination of rights and privacy. If anybody thinks that's a conspiracy theory, you know, that person should just take a cold shower and go online to the World Economic Forum website. You know, if they can't muster the energy to go buy Klaus Schwab's book, which is called The Great Reset.
COVID-19, The Great Reset, no less.
Yeah, right, exactly. I mean, it's, they're making no bones about it. You know, if people say, oh, that's a conspiracy theory, as Justin Trudeau had the gall to do, you know, that's because they don't want to face it, you know, because my favorite definition of conspiracy theory is something that, if true, you couldn't handle it.
You've been listening to part one of my interview with NYU Media Studies Professor Mark Crispin Miller. Stay tuned for part two.